Hi, everybody. My name is Mark Zajac, and I guess I'm going to facilitate this class. I'm not the expert in this, but I'll do the best I can. And a lot of this information I got from the two-year agriculture program here at BCC, and a lot of it came from what you see on the sheet here is from Elliot Coleman. Does anybody know this name, Elliot Coleman? No, well, he's kind of the guru of organic farming, and he does it four seasons. So he has stuff in the ground now. No harvesting carrots and lettuce and stuff like that. The person that I interned with Elliot Coleman. So a lot of the practices that she does, that I witnessed and did with her, she did with Elliot. And he's very particular. He likes his gadgets. He does a very good job growing food all year round and organically. He doesn't use any chemicals. So a lot of the information that I put on that sheet is really from this book. I mean, during the week, I kind of looked through. I'm not an expert in everything. I don't know a lot. But you can always look it up, and it's always in the book. And so what I was going to focus in on is we had Julia. Julia was going to another Seeds of Sustainability member. She was going to talk about composting. What I was going to talk about was crop rotation, crop succession, companion planting, and just basically like planting a garden. And I know garden planting isn't really that sexy. It's one of those things we just want to go in the ground and start planting things that we like. But it's really important. And the bigger that you get, the bigger your project is, the more important it is to collect data. It's almost like if you have a checking, and I'm horrible at this, if you have a checking account, it's like I'll record it later and then you forget and then you bounce a check. And that's kind of the day in the life of me. But it is important. So like gathering as much information as possible will, recording your successes and failures is very, very important, especially down a year from now, because we're hopefully doing this for the long term. We're not just going to plant a garden and then not do it next year. We're going to do it next year and the year after. So this is kind of, we're working with a short-term plan. And we're also working with a long-term plan. And the little changes, and if we add a little smarts to this, we can have a lot of benefits. And a little benefit, and a lot of times, is a big benefit. So crop rotations, does anybody have a garden here right now? Is anybody starting a garden for the first time? No, so you already have kind of land that's already sort of ready for you to go? Because this usually happens in the fall. And I did this because I heard it in class, in theory, and then I said, well, I'm going to put this into practice because it sounds like a good deal, and I don't really like doing a lot of manual work. So what you do is if you have a section of land and it's all grass, you could pitchfork it, but that's a lot of work. What you could do in the fall is put down newspaper, okay? Put some weight down, water it down, put some crop, and then just kind of wait. And then all of a sudden, in the spring, you have this plot of land that kills the sod, grass. Now, I did this, okay? And I realized that grass is pretty tough. And you really have to put down, when I was thinking, I was putting down sheets of newspaper, like individual sheets. And then, of course, just the way Murphy's Law is, that the day that you decide to do that is probably the most windiest day. So you're going to need a lot of weight to sort of put down this newspaper. But my mistake is that I didn't put enough down. And I realized that grass is a lot tougher than I thought. And it started growing past it, and the wind was taking and abusing the newsprint. So what I ended up doing, Susan was another member of Seed Sustainability. She said, well, maybe you need something a little bit tougher. I didn't have enough newsprint, so I ended up putting down cardboard. And cardboard worked. So cardboard's pretty tough. I weighed it down. In the springtime, no grass. And it was empty kind of a space for me to work. So that kind of took one step out of the equation. I didn't really have to break my back lifting, you know, and cutting up the grass. But the thing is with organic gardening, there's a lot of benefits to raised beds. Does anybody have raised beds? You have raised beds. You have raised beds too. There's a lot of benefits to that. I'm gonna draw on the board. And what we did at Roots Farm, and Elliot Coleman does the same thing, is you have a plot of land like this, and it's flat, okay? So what you want to do is you want to, you don't want to compact the soil. So obviously what we're going to do is we're going to make designated rows, okay? So the way Elliot and way Kelly Roberts does it, she does 30 inches right there, and that would be considered a bed. And then she does 12 inches, and that is considered a row. And she repeats that all the way in her plot. And what we do, so we have this plot for the first time, we're going to dig out this row and we're going to put it into this bed here. So really what we're doing is we're creating a mound system, okay? So there's a lot of benefits to that. There's, you know, the temperature of the soil can get raised up a bit. You're dealing with a lot more topsoil than you are, you know, with a flat surface. And there's a lot of other benefits to that. So what we'll do is we will create a system that'll look like this, and she founds this kind of works for her in lots of ways. It fits certain machinery. You're putting all the compaction onto a row, so when you fertilize or amend the soil, you're not really wasting it on the paths. You're really kind of amending just the beds. And once you don't step on these beds, there's no reason to kind of pitchfork it every single year. I used to do that for years, and I just thought that's what gardeners do. They just kind of fluff up the soil. And I think, you know what, the more I read about the organic way of doing something is that we're really just doing it for ourselves. We kind of like the look of fluffed up soil. We think, oh, that's great. It looks perfect, you know? But what happens is, so we have a soil surface, okay? And our pitchfork might come down here and we're fluffing something up like this. Okay, so we're fluffing up all of this surface. But what happens is that this layer over here can create what we call like plow pan. It can create sort of a compaction that we don't see. So an experiment you can do is if you ever take a container of different size seeds, big seeds, small seeds, and you shake it up, just shake it up like this a little bit, you realize that all the different kind of levels of seeds, like the small ones might go on the bottom, the big ones might go on top, and you see this sort of layering system. What could happen is that we could do the same thing with this. You know, if we keep shaking this up over year after year, we can create some sort of barrier, like this plow pan here. And we don't know it, but a lot of compaction can happen below the surface that we don't see. What we have is, in what Elliot uses, what Kelly Roberts uses, is a thing called a broad fork. Does anybody know what a broad fork is? Yeah? Do you want to explain what it is, or do you want?
Well, I don't have one, but I think I'm going to buy one. I've seen Elliot Coleman. It's like a pitchfork, but it's twice as wide, and it's got two handles on it, so you can kind of lean the whole body weight into it rather than...
It's... The blades, I guess they're called blades, right? They're a lot longer than a pitchfork. And what you do is, it's also very, it's somewhat fun, and it's a lot less, it kind of saves your back in a lot of ways. You step on it, and you push down on it, and then you kind of lean back. And you just, what you're doing is you're lifting up the surface, so you're not constantly like tilling, but the forks go down here, and it lifts up the surface like that. So you're aerating the soil, you're lifting it up, you're breaking up compaction. It's good for, you know, soil structure and all that. I don't know if I have a picture of it or not. But what you're doing here is, so what we'll do is when we create a bed, we will broad fork this. So naturally the soil gets all aerated and it gets fluffed up. So normally like this will start getting a much higher than the rows. So we're creating a raised bed in each single spot. The next step we will do is we'll add a lot of compost, and Kelly will first of all do soil samples. So she'll find out what is needed. It may need calcium, magnesium, like the soil might need something. But compost, if you think of compost as like a well-balanced meal. You know, you could always add phosphorus, you could always add magnesium, phosphate, boron, but you think of that as like a vitamin. When we take a vitamin, we're not really having a meal. It's sort of like a very small amendment. But what's really important is a good nutrition. You know, and then we deal with organic gardening the same way. What we're doing is we're really making healthy soil, because that's sort of the structure of our plants being healthy. And when you have healthy plants, you have healthy immune systems. So you don't have all these other problems that come down the line. So what in the beginning, it's really about healthy soil. And crop rotation goes into that. So what happens is, what happens when you plant one plant every single year? It's going to take out the same nutrients that plant wants every single year. And when you don't have the nutrients that the plant needs, the plants will get sicker and have a, you know, their immune systems might be a little lower. So all of a sudden, pests and diseases can take over. If you do the same crop every single year in one plot, diseases would like to make a little home for themselves. And they're going to say, okay, this is a great place to eat corn all year round. So what we like to do, just like nature does, we like to add diversity to our garden. And diversity is good. Monocultures, you find, if you can look it up, will cause a lot of havoc. You can see with the potato famine in Ireland, when you had one type of potato. You know, if you're putting all your eggs in one basket, if one disease finds the key to breaking that down, your whole crop is wiped out. So diversity is the key. Yes?
I have a question about crop rotation. Does that also go for string beans, the green beans? Because don't they make their own nitrogen?
Yes, they, yeah.
Should still rotate them?
Well, that's a good question, because in Elliot's book, he uses legume. It's in the legume family. He uses it as a cash crop. Cash crop meaning that he uses it to pick and to sell and to eat. He also uses legume crops to as a cover crop, because it does do that. It fixes nitrogen into the soil. It's a great succession crop for other plants. And if you look on one of the sheets, that one right there, he uses some legume plants in succession to each other. So I think peas and beans, I think there are a few plants that he plants right next to each other that are legumes. And I think that might be okay. But we'll get to that in a few.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. Crop rotation, I'm just going to talk about the soil health. In other words, when you put different crops in different beds, it's going to have different needs. So one of the key rules to crop rotation is, when in doubt, it has all these patterns, you know, maybe beans come great after corn or after potatoes, but the number one rule is try to plant something that's not within the same family, when in doubt. Soil nutrition, the leguminous crops, adds nitrogen to the soil. So you might have plants that are definitely heavy feeders. You know, corn might be a very heavy feeder. Like tomatoes might be a heavy feeder. They need a lot of something like nitrogen. A crop like beans or peas might be perfect to go right before those crops. Soil structure, we were talking about compaction. There's actually crops that you can grow that can minimize that. When I started taking the ag classes, Professor Corbin, who was here, brought in these big things. Like, can anybody tell me what this is? And it was this really long thing. It didn't look like carrot, it was white. And somebody said it's a daikon radish. He's right. And he planted those specifically, not to eat, but to break up the compaction. So you think about this plant, and it's doing the work for you. It's growing this root system all the way down into the dirt for you, and it's breaking up. It's adding organic matter, which is really good for the soil. It's breaking up this compaction. It's also mining, and you have these plants called like miners. They will dig their roots all the way down, and they will eat a lot of the minerals that other plants, like the shallow roots plants, can't get at. And they'll bring it up to the top. And what you'll do is, you know, if you use it as a mulch or you turn it in, all those minerals from really below are coming to the top for next year's purposes. Crop yields, obviously, if you're getting good nutrition, the crops are going to do better and it's going to yield better. And you think about it, even if it's a small percentage, say like a crop only yields more like 2% because you do these crop rotations. You think about 2% times how many crop rotations you do that year times every single year, and you realize that a small difference can really add up. It's cumulative, right? It really, really adds up. So, and pest control, we talked about that. It's, pests have a certain niche. There's certain pests that like brassicas. There's certain ones that like cabbage and broccoli and stuff. And I've learned this from experience. I've seen this firsthand, that if you decide to put all the brassicas in one spot. And it does kind of make sense in our heads. It makes sense that, like, for management purposes, this is where my corn's going to be, this is where my brassica is going to be, this is where my tomato's going to be. There's some pros to that. It's like management is, means that that's where it's going to be. It's really easy to rotate a four-crop system. But the cons would be that a lot of pests that do like that particular crop are going to wreak havoc on your broccolis and cauliflower and cabbage and stuff. So a lot of farmers, even though it's kind of a pain in the butt to put cabbage here and here or broccoli here and here, it might confuse pests. It might say that if one's attacking this crop, they might not know about this crop over here. So you're trying to protect certain crops and, again, not putting all of your eggs in one basket. I've seen it firsthand, like, we had sort of way too many brassicas in one spot, and they were really getting hit hard by pests. And so that leads to the next topic, cover crops. Cover crops are, what's a cover crop? It's one of those crops that you don't ever want to put your soil fallow. So in other words, I don't know if you've ever seen this, but when gardeners stop gardening, all you see is dirt, right? You want like another crop to work for your soil, because when you see in nature, you don't really any see blanketed. If something is just blanketed in nature, there's something wrong with that soil. There's always something growing. And so in organic farming, we try to mimic what's going on in nature. So a cover crop is, if you have blank soil, a lot of that nitrogen can be kind of leached off. A lot of the amendments that you put into the ground could be leached by rain, snow. A lot of the nitrogen can vaporize. So what we would like to do is keep what we worked really hard to do is keep the nutrition into the soil. So how do we do that? We put a crop on. So we put a crop on, like, say, winter rye, okay? So the winter rye will grow. It'll hold the nitrogen. It will grow really large if you allow it to. And sometimes winter rye can be kind of a problem that way. But the root systems can go really far down into the ground. And that's great, because if the root systems are going really far into the ground, it's breaking up a lot of the soil compaction. It's mining a lot of the minerals. It's adding a lot of biomass. It's allowing a lot of, the root systems are adding a lot of organic matter into the soil. So there's a lot of benefits to cover crops. If you do a legume, like peas or soybeans or beans, it adds nitrogen to the soil. So not just keeping the nitrogen in the soil, it's about also gathering nitrogen, the free nitrogen in our air, tons of it in our air right now. We're adding that into the soil. And of course the soil structure with the root systems and stuff like that. And if you allow it to go, I mean, if you have a lot of land and you want to say, okay, I'm going to do that next year. In fact, actually that happened at Roots Farm in Tiverton. They just started their process. They worked with a couple of plots, but in the future they were thinking of other plots. So they would have one guy till one spot, and then they throw oats down, or they throw rye down. And they said that's going to be for 2013 or 14 or 15. So they're thinking ahead of time, you know, and the cover crops are great, like, I'm preparing this for next season. So if you let it go, if it blooms, it flowers, it's great for a lot of, you know, bees or a lot of insects that pollinate. So anyway, the next thing, I was thinking about making this somewhat interactive. Okay, so you see this thing called the crop rotation game? You see this here? On this page. And this page, okay. So you have the crop rotation game. Here's on one page you have the crop family. So you have the Latin term, and then you have all the common names. So if you didn't know, like, oh, cabbages are related to cauliflower, related to kale, some of them that, you know, I didn't really know that they actually were in the same group. There's one where I call it the mint family. I'm not going to pronounce that, butcher that Latin name. But basil is related to mint, is related to rosemary and thyme and sage. There's certain ones that, just out of convenience, we call them root crops, like carrots and beets. They're different families, but it's okay because they kind of are very similar. So what we're going to do is, you see this chart here. Okay, and with crop rotation, this is a very simple linear chart. And what we're going to do is a very simple game. These are 8 beds. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and we're thinking of an 8-year plan. Now, with gardeners, you might not have to go 8 years. You might want to customize this however you want it. If you have 4 beds, 4 years, it really depends on what you want to grow. So, for instance, what's going to happen is that this crop is next year is going to go to this bed, which is going to go to this bed. So if I have tomatoes here on bed number one, it's going to go into new soil next year. It's going to go into new soil the next year. So for 8 years, that tomato plant is going to have fresh soil. In the case, you know, you don't necessarily want to plant tomatoes in the same spot every single time. So what's going to happen is another crop's going to take its place. So the clues are what patterns that farmers and Elliot Coleman has found. You know, he might say that, oh, potatoes work really well after corn. And like, okay, that's a clue. And then says, oh, legumes really work before tomatoes. And like, okay, that's a pattern that, you know, people have recorded. And you know what? There are probably a lot of patterns and they're very specific to each crop. It's not that you have to know each one, because if you buy seeds, like from Johnny's has a lot of information on its site where you can go and you can download PDFs about each individual crop, what's good before it, what's good to succeed it, the growing rates, the maturity and all that. So depending on what kind of crop you can grow, you can look up that information yourself. But these are just sort of like little clues about what you can plant before and after, okay? So, and if you wanted to plant two tomatoes, so if you want 2 beds of tomatoes, does anybody have an idea of like where to put them? So if you're going from bed one to two, just say theoretically, maybe you want to do something differently with your garden, but we're going to go in to the right. So each one is going to go this way. So, but what about if we want 2 beds of tomatoes? You know, if we put them side by side, bed one is going to take over bed two, and you don't want, by the rules of the game, you don't want necessarily 2 spots with the same plant, okay? Or in the same family. So does anybody want to take that on? What would you do? What would you do? 2 tomato beds, or, all right, in this case, you want tomatoes and potatoes. Now, if you know any farmer says, don't plant potatoes next to tomatoes. And so we're not only just keeping them spatially apart, we're also keeping them time-wise apart. So if tomatoes are going to be over here, 1, 2, 3, 4 years from now, it'll be here. So maybe the best thing to do is to put tomatoes here and maybe potatoes here. So that way you have about 3 or 4 year difference. By the time tomatoes and potatoes, they'll never meet, you know, in succession of each year. Does everybody get that? Yeah? So I'm going to draw this on the board. And I was hoping that maybe we could do it together. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oops. Oop. 8. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay. And we're going to go this direction. So what's going to happen with this plant is that will eventually be, it'll go in a cycle. So it'll go all the way back. So it's a rotation, obviously, right? So what about if we want potatoes and tomatoes? So maybe we can put tomatoes, let me see, over here. So, and so by the time it gets, oh, maybe it'd be over here. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So tomatoes. And then, so you have about 4 years from potatoes. Okay, and that will have 1, 2, 3, 4 years from tomatoes. Does everybody get that? Right? Or this could be tomatoes too. You know, I was just thinking of 2 in the same family. So in this case, you know, it could be 2 tomatoes or a potato and tomatoes. And so by the time it gets to this bed, you already have three or four different crops that have grown there. So the rotation is, you have a 3-4 year rotation. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay. So, all right, so anybody, I'm looking for input. What crops do you want to grow? We'll try to fit it into the mix. And again, I haven't read the clues, so you'll have to tell me which ones. So if you want some time to read through.
Sweet corn?
Okay. Oh, that's a good one, yeah. Sweet corn. So sweet corn in bed one. Yeah. In fact, if you like sweet corn would be really good in 7, I think, right? Yeah. I actually firsthand know that potatoes really do well after corn. There was, when I was a kid, we had this acre of land, and it's really quite rare to have that in Fall River, but my grandfather kind of cultivated half of it. And being older, he kind of took on a lot more than he could chew. And so I got employed to plow and dig and stuff like that. But we did all the tomatoes, the cucumbers, all the things that we liked. And then half of it was just corn. And then same thing, he would get really, really enthusiastic from the first half, and the other part was just corn. So corn was just sort of that, I don't care what it does over there, just let it grow something. But it was year after year, it was corn, corn, corn. And then I got older, I got kind of interested in it. It's like, hey, Grandpa, can I do something over there? Like, yeah, do whatever you want. So I ended up like, well, I like potatoes, I'm gonna grow potatoes. And I grew potatoes, and I just could not wait to harvest. Because it was like all year round. I was cultivating it, mounding it, weeding it. And then finally, I decided to dig them up, and I dug up, I couldn't believe, like a couple of wheelbarrow full of potatoes. And they were big, and they were huge. And it was like all that time. And it was just out of coincidence. It was just that because that field had all that corn all that time, it was really ripe for potatoes, it seemed like. So I had a really good batch. I was really quite pleasantly surprised about how well the potatoes did in that section. But, so does anybody else have a favorite crop?
Beans.
Beans would be good.
Before the tomatoes?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. So, before the tomatoes?
No.
Oh yeah. Okay. That's cool. Yeah, because this might add like you know some nitrogen for the tomatoes. Actually, yeah. So beans. Actually, you know, legume families are really good because they're not too picky, and they're great. Like for instance, when we said that we needed to have some time space between tomatoes and tomatoes, or potatoes and potatoes. Legumes are really good to be in between crops. They're great to you know fixate the soil with nitrogen, and you need something to grow here. You know to separate these two same families. So legumes are definitely great to put in between the major crops. So like I like tomatoes, so I might want to grow a lot of tomatoes, and if I'm going to do a rotation system, I want to in between crops. And beans are definitely a good one. Let me see, what does Elliot Coleman do? The ones that you have to kind of watch out for is, and I didn't know this until actually I started reading it, is apparently, according to Elliot Coleman, is beets and carrots, the root crops. And why is that? Well, there's certain plants that kind of, they intake chemicals, but they also may outtake chemicals. And some plants don't mind that, you know. But others might, you know, and they're called detrimental crops. Elliot Coleman says that you have to be kind of careful with them. There's some crops that you want to put next to them where they don't mind it so much. There might be others that will not be too happy if carrots grew there a year before, or beets. Now, I don't know if that's contested or not. I don't know if anybody's seen, you know, anything about that. But that's what Elliot Coleman says. So a part of the crop rotation is not just you know, it's not to cause harm to other plants too. It's not just for benefit. It's also sort of for prevention. So, but if you want to grow root crops, that's perfectly fine. You just have to just keep that in mind. You know, they have to grow somewhere. So what would you want to put in? Anybody else have an input?
Squash is after potatoes.
Yep. Oh, okay.
So that goes with 6 or 7?
Squash, so it says here, squash after potatoes, grows after potatoes. Okay. So what about, you say 6 or 7?
Well,
yeah. Yep. Okay, well, all right, we'll just, it's not written in stone, so it's just planning it out. Oh, squash, I know this one. Squash. And what would be good before squash? Yeah, that's right. So this is kind of a puzzle, right? So in a lot of cases, it's good to do it in pencil because you're like, oh, okay, you know, there's probably a better way of doing this. But it's sort of like a puzzle. You kind of have to fit them in. And you know what? It doesn't have to be perfect. But the main rule is that you're not putting relative plants in the same family in succession to one another. That's kind of one of the main rules. So you might have a wide variety. And it gets, you know, the variables get kind of complicated when you have more beds, when you have a longer year plant, and you're adding cover crops. So let me see. How about if we put, what about, does anybody want to grow lettuce? Yeah, we could grow some lettuce or something like that, right? So what about put sort of greens or something? And greens could be a lot of different kind of greens, mustards and salad mixes and spinach and all that.
If you're growing these crops next to each other in like say the same raised beds, will there be a similar effect like throughout the growing season? So if you have squash and potatoes next to each other in one bed.
Mm-hmm. Oh, in one bed?
Yeah.
That's kind of known as the three sisters, I suppose. So there's one point, there's another growing method, is that you can actually have crops grow with each other. So in a lot of cases, the Native Americans would grow is, if I get this right, is a mound of soil, and the corn would grow up. Okay. And they would put a fish here. And it would be kind of like their little, like, you know, little piece of composting matter. And so what would happen is they will plant beans, right? So the beans would go up the stalks, right? So it'd be like, you know, the stalks, the corn would grow up pretty high. And the beans will follow up the corn. So it'll like have a pole. It's like a natural pole for the beans to grow up. And so now you have all this land here. So also the squash. So the beans would be fixing nitrogen too. So it'd be fixing nitrogen for these other two crops. The third sister would be a cover crop like that would be squash. So a lot of viney crops, like a pumpkin or a squash, and they would just kind of fall down onto the hill. Like this, so we'll have room to sort of migrate. And a squash is a great crop for, it's called a cleansing crop. And the reason why they call it a cleansing crop is because it helps weed. So if you have like, say, carrots, it's real kind of a pain in the butt to like weed carrots, but you want to diminish the weed factor as much as possible. So what you want to do is if you have two crops that are cleansing crops, those are ones that cover the whole grounds, like pumpkins or squash or something like that, that might be a good one to follow to have the root crops come after. So that's why they call it a cleansing crop. But the three sisters are the ones that you have three that relatively work well together. Corn, a legume like beans, the climbing type that uses the corn as a structure, and then the squash to cover the whole base around. Has anybody ever heard of that before? Yeah, you've heard of that, no? Yeah.
I was thinking that you got the beans and then tomatoes, which works good because the beans fix nitrogen. And
okay.
The tomatoes like nitrogen, like for the corn too, you get a symbiotic relationship.
Yeah.
But is there other plant combinations too that one thing likes something that the other thing leaves behind that you could?
I mean, there's these are like a few patterns that I found in the book. So anyway, just to fill this, we have two more. And so say like Brassica is like a huge family. All right, Brassicas could be, if you look on the families list, it's, you know, it covers cabbages, kale, turnips, radishes, broccoli. I mean, it could add up a lot. So if you wanted to, you could add, I don't know, say a cabbage here. And cabbage, I'm just going to put cabbage because that could be a lot. That could be a lot of brassica. I don't know. It could be, you know, it could be broccoli. It could be cabbage. And then also, I don't know, the last one, do you think of anything that you could put in there?
Carrots.
All right. So within, 5 minutes, we came up with an 8-year plan. So in a lot of cases, if we were just doing this willy-nilly, we might get overly complicated. It might be like my checking account. I forget what I took out, and I'll bounce a check. In a lot of cases, if we do a little organizing, those little percentages really add up in the long term. And that's what we're going for, is a long-term process. We're trying to create something that will give us a continuous yield, instead of giving us, you know, confusion and then detriment. So anyway, I hope everybody got that. Was that okay? Yeah? We'll talk about cover crops. What I have here is, this is a very simple rotation, an 8-year rotation plan, which is very helpful for the long term, but it's not helpful if we're doing, okay, we're starting a garden this year. We have to kind of look at the specifics this year. This is an example of what a 1-year system can look like. And obviously, you probably figured it out, but the initials here, it means the January, February, so all the months of the year. So I have a 12-year plan. It's not, you know, gardeners just don't go from May to October. We go all year round. So what I want to break it down is we have a very, very simple 4-bed system, okay? So we have the beds that I explained earlier, and we have time, so the months of the year. So as you see, these are called vetch, white clover, soybeans. Those are cover crops. Those are crops that, assumingly, we have grown the previous year, and we let them out in the field and we overwintered them. Rye, for instance, winter rye is a very cold hardy plant. You could germinate it in, say, September, let it grow a little bit, and it'll take off if you let it go in the spring. In some cases, does anybody know the term green manure? No, it's sometimes I got a little confused with cover crop and green. Green manure is a cover crop, but it's a very particular crop. It's it could be any one of those cover crops that I listed, but what you do is before it reaches maturity, you know, the rye doesn't, you know, it could grow up to like the size of you, 6 feet, if you let it to. But if you allow it to grow 4 inches or 5 inches, you turn it into the ground. And it's sort of a green fertilizer. What you're doing is when you turn it into the ground and you kill it, it'll decompose. And you're adding nutrition, you're adding organic matter, and so you're getting ready for that bed to plant your cash crop. So that's a green manure. And Elliot Coleman talks, there's a whole chapter on just green manures. It's about taking like white clover and turning it in, you know. Companion planting is another cover crop. It's not about killing the crop and turning it in. It's about letting it grow with the cash crop, and that's perfectly fine. And then other cover crops like oats, for instance, They can grow, but they're not winter hardy. So theoretically, they die in the winter. Last winter, I had oats and they didn't die because we had such a warm winter. So theoretically, you let the oats grow, and it'll be like a mulch. So it'll die in the winter time. And if you see fields of oats on a hardy winter, they're all kind of dead. But it's good because that's organic matter and that's mulching the soil. So earlier when I said you don't let the earth go fallow, what I mean is you either have something growing, or another alternative is to have it mulched. And what I've done before is, did anybody hear of lasagna gardening or side sheet mulching? Lasagna mulching? Well, I think somebody coined it a lasagna because it's like layering. So you have your soil, right? And say you want to put cardboard. So you put cardboard, that's organic matter. And what other stuff that you could put on there? I go to Costa Roasters in Tiverton. Ever go there? Well, they have buckets of coffee grounds every single time. There's never any shortage of coffee grounds. And what I do is I put coffee grounds on there. So does anybody go to the beach in the wintertime? I do. And I get seaweed, and I put seaweed on top of there. And then also, does anybody compost? You know, compost? When you compost, and that's, you know, in the springtime, you can throw that on there. So you're putting layers and layers of organic matter, and you're just letting nature take its course. You're letting nature just let it decompose and feed from the top, you know? So that is what we call, if anybody wants to look it up, it's called sheet mulching. I was maintaining this community garden in New Bedford, and I was kind of doing it willy-nilly, but it's fine, you know, it's not like rocket science. But anyway, I had this one plot, and I just put down a whole ton of seaweed. I put a whole ton of coffee grounds, and then I planted basil there. And I've never seen basil grow like it, the way it grew. It grew not like a plant, it grew like a bush. It really grew like this. I mean, it was really quite remarkable how it grew. And all I can do is make a correlation. I can't say it was a direct result of what we were doing. But, I mean, it's a pretty strong correlation, I think. Because the soil wasn't all that great. It wasn't like new compost soil. But I think, you know, I think sheet mulching is a great thing. You know, if you ever go to the beach, it's free, you know, it's free local organic matter. But so cover crops, I was going this. So what we're going to do is, if you notice, this is not terribly accurate, but if you notice that hairy vetch is in the legume family, so it's fixating nitrogen, okay? You notice that there's a gap between where the vetch ends and where the tomatoes begin. And that is a reason, if you're going to turn it in, if you have a plant in your bed and you turn it in, you don't necessarily want to plant the tomato right afterwards. You want to let it, what farmers will say, let it settle. So it's decomposing, it's you know, it's breaking down, it's decomposing. Let it do that for about 3 or 4 weeks before you put your transplants in. But in the meantime, hopefully you have started your tomato plants indoors. So we'll get to that as far as calendars. So this is kind of like a crop rotation in a sense, but it's sort of our year plan. We have the cover crop, and then we have tomatoes, and then all of a sudden there's something interesting here, is now we have companion planting. Elliot Coleman plants oats with his tomatoes. And how does he do that? Well, the thing is that tomatoes, when you have them established, they're okay with having weeds. But if you're gonna have weeds, you might as well have beneficial weeds. So what you're gonna do is you're going to have your tomatoes, well-established plants. He's gonna plant his oats probably around late August and early September. And those will germinate. And then when you're done with the tomatoes, you already have a cover crop growing oats. So he's thinking, it's all about the planning, you know? It's once you have your cash crop, your vegetables in there, established and growing, it's not competing with weeds. If you plant them at the same time, tomatoes might have a little struggle because they're both competing for the, you know, sun and moisture and nutrients. So once you have your green beans, sweet corn, your tomatoes established and big, you can plant your companion planting and your cover crops. And that way, once you take out your sweet corn, your soybeans will be there for the winter. If you take out your tomato plants, your oats will already be established. So that's why you have sort of the way Elliott Coleman does it, is you have an overlap. And if you read more about it, it's, you know, certain times, like in here, it's like he'll do it after maybe 6 weeks of sweet corn. When the corn plants are already about this high, they're okay. They're not gonna like be fighting with other plants for, you know, survival. So, and then a lot of cases, you know, the white clover seems to work pretty well as a before plant crop for sweet corn. And then soybeans seems to work really well with, and it grows with sweet corn. And then in this case, you know, if you have soybeans growing and you keep it in the wintertime, that's a great succession for potatoes, you know. And again, you have that gap because if you turn in the soybean plants, you want to let it decompose, and then you have the potatoes to grow. So, and winter rye is one of those that if you think about planting, and winter rye is pretty winter hardy. So I've started winter rye in September when you think that everything's done growing. And it can last. I mean, it'll grow and be green throughout the winter, and then it'll just really take off when the spring comes. So you have to be really careful, because there was one time, I think maybe all farmers maybe made the same mistake, is that you allow winter rye to grow really, really large, and then you're like, oh crap, what do I do with that? Because if you need that bed, you have to think ahead of time. You have to think, oh, I need that bed for tomorrow. You know, it's really be a shame to have to pull all that out and put it away. I think the best thing to do is take the winter rye before it gets really large and turn it in when it's small and allow it to decompose, and then you put your crop in. So this is kind of a good visual for the first year, all right? And what I would do is after that, you go from very basic to a little bit more specific to something that's much more specific. And again, I'm yet to do this because, you know, I'm yet to do my checking account. But this, you know, calendar. So what you do is you write down what needs to be done throughout the year. So you're not kind of like, what do I do today? You know that you have to, oh, I got to start the seeds for my lettuce. I got to start the seeds for my tomatoes. So does anybody know when they should start their seeds indoors for tomatoes? Like, you can't think of it offhand. So you write it down. You know, this is part of the garden planning stage. What you do is you think of when's it really around here to put out what's the best time to put out tomato plants around here? Everybody should know this, huh? Do you know the best? What's the sort of the old-time farmers, when do they usually put out their tomato plants? Give and take, you know, a warm spring or a late spring. It's
Memorial Day.
Yes, she's got it, Memorial Day. That's usually the three-day weekend, right? So that's the time where it's safe. Now, if, you know, a lot of people try to cheat that. They try to go a couple of weeks. I think last year, because it was so warm, I ended up putting out like a week before. You don't want to put out too early because, you know, it's probably best when the soil's warm. Those plants will really, really take off. But a lot of people like to get a head start. And sometimes they put it out where the nights are kind of cold, and those plants get damaged, you know, because the tomatoes are really warm-loving plants. But anyway, okay, so you have that. So you put down, you know, you go to Memorial Day, you write down, okay, that's the time I'm going to put out my plants. But when do you start the seeds? I don't know. So anyway, you go and you find out when you plant the seeds. So you find out, in this case, I know it's 6 to 8 weeks. So you know that you need 6 to 8 weeks to grow the plant indoors. When it's at that point, that's a great optimal time to put it outside. So you count backwards. Okay, so May, so we have May here. Okay, Memorial Day. So you go 1, 2, 3, 4. And then probably 5, 6. And then I like to maybe 8 weeks. So I think this right here would be a good time to start the seeds. So you have at least 8 weeks. You probably don't want to go farther than that, but you have 8 weeks. So in this time you write down starting seeds. And then you do that for every crop. Okay? And then, so you have an idea of what to do when. And I think that's very, very important. I think a lot of people kind of forget that and they just kind of just wing it. But the more complicated your garden gets, the more you kind of rely on this. Farmers really, they have like applications now online. There's one called Ag Squared. And the more, because if your income really relies on this, you really have to put in this data and you really have to be very, very organized for it to work. So you have that for every single crop. And also, like anything else that you might want to put on the calendar, it could be like when to start your cover crops if you apply to do that. So if you want to experiment putting like maybe some light dwarf clover with your tomatoes, or if you want to plant your soybeans with your sweet corn, if you want to experiment that way, it's really crucial to know when to do that. You might want to do it 6 weeks after the sweet corn have been established. So you mark it on your calendar. You know, okay, you know, I'm not going to like remember this. So I'm going to allow my camera to keep this information so I know in July 4th, that's when I plant my soybeans. And so that organization, even though it may seem, I've always said that before, yeah, whatever, you know, I'll remember. You forget, you really do. And so it's so easy to put this down. And then you really kind of like, this is what I have now. You know, and this is my daily things for the club. So I know that if I look visually, like, oh yeah, I got that coming up on Wednesday. So the same thing with the garden. So once you have your calendar, the last thing is a garden journal. Has anybody ever kept a garden journal? This is the most specific thing in the world. Now the thing is, why is a garden journal important? It sounds like a diary, but you know what? It's really important to record your successes. It's really important to record your failures, because you might not want to do that again. And again, a lot of times we kind of think I'll remember that, and you don't. You really don't. Not especially the small minutia of details. So there is a lot of information that's going around in your garden that you might want to record on a daily basis. It might have been a wet spring, and you're thinking, well, these plants are not doing so well. Or it might have been cold. It might be doing so well. You might want to record that, and you might find out that that might have been the purpose, that you have these pests or this fungus disease, or that the plant didn't work very well. And that stuff that's so, like, if it's so much information, it's easy to forget. And then a year from now, you can go back and say, oh, that kind of worked out. Maybe I can sort of repeat that. So there's information like with journaling is temperature, like what the weather and the climate is like, what plants you planted. You could actually, they have, some farmers have journals and they'll have a notebook and they'll section it off with each crop. You know, like the tomatoes this year of 2013, they'll have like, okay, this did well, but I had this pest. You know, cucumbers might have a disease. You might want to record that. So that way, if that had disease there, you might want to move it away next year. Because, you know, if you have a disease there, you probably don't want to put the same kind of family. So again, about recording data, if you put cucumbers and it didn't do well and it had this sort of mold or blight or something, you might not want to put something in that family there, and you might have forgotten. So I know it might seem kind of tedious, but it really is a very important for management's sake, for gardening. So with that is, actually the last thing I was going to mention is I was looking up some like online applications, and Ag Squared is kind of it's a pretty intense, if you ever look that up, if Google it, it's a pretty intense software. It's really meant for farmers, and farmers that have big plots. And if you type in your address, there's a satellite that comes down on your plot, and you can actually outline it, and then you can hone in on it and put the different kind of crops in there. It's really quite intense. There's one, I found some for little smartphones and stuff, but I don't have that thing. But I found one that I really, really liked. And I didn't have time to print out an example, but it's called growveg.com. It's in this little reference box. And you can get it for 30 days as a free trial, but you know what, you don't have to. What they'll do is they'll send you, you can fill in the calendar, and it'll send you email updates. Oh, don't forget to weed this, don't forget to plant this. right? If you want to be online like that. But the thing is, with a 30-day trial, if you actually plan out your garden, you can print it out. And it'll print out, what I like about it is that you print out all the information. I like this tomato, I'm planting it this, this is when I'm transplanting it, this is what root crop. It'll actually make one of these for you. So it will show you one of these, you can hang it up on your wall, and you can know where and when to plant something. That's what I really like about it. What I also like about it too is that when you have the measurements of your bed, say you have 20 feet by 30 inches, you can make it a rectangle with that, and you say, okay, I'm gonna plant a bean, string beans. You grab the little icon, and it'll spread all over that row, but it will do it in ratio. So it has the plant and the spacing of what spacing is needed. So it'll plant, like it'll show you how many plants that should ought to go in that bed, which is really nice.
What's the name of that thing?
It's called growveg.com. It's right here in the reference. Yeah, right there. Yeah.
One of the things that I have a hard time is figuring out planning for production.
Yeah.
You know, how much production is each plant?
Yeah. Giving. That's a good one. That's a really good one. I wish I had that book with this. But in organic agriculture, the second part is management. And there's this book. And if you are planning to make money in farming, and actually I think in anything, you have to think in reverse. So it's not just, maybe a lot of people have this assumption that what you do is you grow a hell of a lot of something and then you have all this stuff and you kind of, now I've got to find a market and then I got to dump it on this market and then whatever is left over is what I make. Well, all right, have that. Now think in reverse. Think about right now, it's winter, and you think about how much money do I want to make? $100,000. Okay, I'll make $100,000. So you write $100,000, right? And then you think, well, what do I have to do to get that $100,000? Okay, well, I got 4 plants that I want to plant. Well, how much do you have to plant? Well, it depends on the prices of the markets. Are you going to sell to farmers markets? Are you going to sell to restaurants? So you find your markets, okay, and then you find out what price you're going to get for that market. And you have to be kind of realistic about that. And then what you do is you find out how much I need to grow to match that price, to match the $100,000. And you might find out that $100,000, you have to grow a hell of a lot of stuff. But the idea is that you think of like how much money you need to make, and then you think about what the prices are in the markets and what markets you can fill. And then you think about how much production do you need to get from that to get that.
Is there a good resource though to find out that one tomato plant is going to produce how many pounds of?
Yeah, yeah. I think on Johnny Selected Seeds, it might be other seed companies too, but I think they're pretty thorough. You go and you look up the plant and you look up the info for that individual plant. It'll show the maturity rate of the plant. It should show the production, or I think the average production. If not, I think Professor Corbin might know the answer to that. Yeah. But like, does everybody get that idea? Like the idea of work in reverse? You have to, if you think about the money that you need to make for your farm, and you think about that rules the production, how much you need to actually make in order to get that money. In a lot of cases, we had to fill out these forms and we found out that the next, I mean, obviously the first year you might make 25,000, but each year you get better at it because you become more efficient. You know how to do things better. You learn how to do tasks quicker because money, like the more time that you spend on a project or weeding or any kind of task, that's money. That's really, really time is money. So you, in farming, you're in it for profit. You have to realize it's a business. If you take anything out of that idea, it's not just planning a heck of a lot of stuff and then hoping that somebody buys it along the line. You have this idea, like CSS, you have this idea that you have a market already established. How do I supply that market?